acts from all over the world. Thousands of people came to hear them speak. Keisha Kurokawa and Kiyonori Kikutake from Japan. Some of you may not be familiar with these names, but they're people who have really achieved quite a bit of recognition internationally. Herman Hertzberger and Aldo van Eyck from Holland. Helgi Bofinger from Germany. Rod Hackney from the from London, Russian architects, Vakhtang Daivadaya, who will be joining us later this year, architects from China, Japan, France, and everywhere. Now, these architects were very well received by the thousands of students and practitioners that came to hear them speak. Some of them were even Spanish-speaking architects. Cesar Pelli, for example, who is a native of Argentina but practicing in the United States, spoke and was very well received. There was one architect who spoke last November in Argentina who I think was the one that received the warmest welcome of all and the greatest recognition when he was finished presenting his work. He presented his work in a very complete style from the very first projects that he did until the most recent ones. The thing that made his presentation more unique than any of the others was not the quantity of work that he showed. Certainly the quality was excellent. The thing that made it the most unique in my mind and in the mind of most of the people who heard him make this presentation was his tremendous degree of humility. That person was Felix Candela, who's here with us this evening. Felix Candela was born in 1910 in Madrid, and he's lived in Mexico and in Spain and in New York, and received his training in Spain, has been professor of architecture at the University of Mexico. He also was chairman of the Department of Construction there, and also taught until recently at the University of Illinois at Chicago Circle. For 20 years, he was the president of his own company with subsidiaries around the world. He constructed reinforced concrete, thin shell structures, the type of which have this type of structure has given him prominence all over the world. The book Candela, The Shell Builder, has been translated into German and Spanish as well as English. Dr. Candela has been a professor of poetry at Harvard, has held distinguished chairs at the University of Virginia, Cornell University, the university, universities in Madrid, in Leeds, in the United Kingdom, and in Peru. And his list of awards is equally extensive, the gold medal recipient of the Institute for Structural Engineers in the United Kingdom, the August Parade Prize by the International Union of Architects in London, Doctor of Fine Arts at the University of New Mexico, Doctor of Engineering from Venezuela, Doctor of Fine Arts from the University of Illinois, the Silver Medal for Research from the Academy of Architecture in Paris, the Gold Medal from the Architects in Spain, and on and on. He's an honorary member of architectural organizations all around the world. Dr. Candela, when we invited him here, explained that in order for him to present his life's work, 50 minutes is a little difficult, so he asked if he could possibly have 20 or 30 extra minutes so that he could give you a more comprehensive view of all his projects. If some of you have to renew your passport or travel out of town or be somewhere else this evening and you need to leave, we'll understand that. I appreciate the fact that he came here from Madrid through New York just to come here to Muncie to speak to you. He's going back to Switzerland when he leaves here to work on a collaborative project with another architect for a new bridge for Paris. It's a great pleasure and an honor for me to introduce to you somebody who really deserves the title master. I really would like to have you all join me in welcoming Felix Candela.
Thank you very much, Marvin. You have been extremely kind with me. And they don't need to believe everything he has said, you see. I'm going to talk tonight don't expect to hear anything about architecture or modern architecture, postmodern architecture, anything like that. I'm just trying to show you some of the things I have done, some of the things I have built, because I did not work as an architect most of the time, even if I am an architect by training, but I was working as a contractor in Mexico, because in order to build the kind of a structure that you are going to see, I had to build them myself. It was very difficult for me to just doing the drawings or something and then go for bids and nobody will bid properly or something. So the only way to build these things was to do it myself with my own company, building company. So what I am really is a contractor, in spite of everything you have heard about me. I am going to talk of two things which are very important, I believe, in this question of construction, in this business of construction. One of them is the scale. It's very, when you have to read some paper, engineering paper about any kind of structure, it's very rarely that you hear anything about the range of dimensions that a structure is suited for. And that is very important because each type of construction has a limit, a sensible limit of size that you cannot overpass without paying extra money and extra danger and extra risk and many, many, many things. So one thing is the scale. When you are building something at the proper scale, you don't even need to do too complicated calculations. I mean, the simplest one, which you can understand and you can feel, are enough. When you overdo the size, then you have to go to all kinds of complications, and you are never sure that the thing is going to work. But this is something that, unfortunately, nobody tells you in the books or in the articles. It's something that I have to learn by myself. The other thing which I think is important is also the question of beauty. Very, very rare also among architects to talk of beauty. Apparently, that is a bad word in architecture. If something is beautiful, something must be wrong with the architectural product. I mean, it's not in fashion, in other words. Beauty is not in fashion. It has to be ugliness or brutalism or whatever, but not beauty. I mean, if something is beautiful, you have to hide it and say, well, no, it was not my fault, you see, something like that. Well, looking back at, because other thing is that tonight I am going to show you things which are very old. I mean, most of these things, I think all these things probably are older than most of the audience. They were built before you were born. And so is nothing new about them. It's nothing, it's everybody should know. But what happened is they have become out of fashion. So nobody cares anymore for this structure. So it has become some kind of historical subject. So I'm going to be my own historian tonight. And well, I think that is some of the things I believe, looking back, because now from time to time, when I give a lecture, I look at the pictures and say, well, some of the structures are really very beautiful, but I will say that it has not been my fault, you see, if they are beautiful. Well, may I have the lights and the start with you? Because I think I have a lot of slides and I think I would like to explain them to you. I don't know, this machine. This is terrible, this. Well, this is one of the first structures we built in Mexico. I mean, it is the, I don't know what is, if I am going to make some. Well, this is one of the first one in which we try to kind of industrialize the building process. So you see, it's a very simple structure. It's just a cylindrical vault with two cantilevers at both sides. And the ties, you cannot see in this picture, but you will see it in the next one, the tie is put in top, so that the under side of the structure is totally clean, so we can move the forms there. Next one, one word. Yeah, it's better this way. Well, you see, this is another view. Could you focus a little? I don't know if you can see it well. Well, these are the ties in top, and these other ties are supporting the edge of the cantilever. This is about 70 feet, 20 meters, 21 meters, and 6 meters, 20 feet outside a cantilever, at both sides. So we could move the formwork from one position to the next in a very easy way, with no obstruction, just dropping it a little, moving it on the concrete pavement. And it was a very fast and very economical way, because I proved also that all these structures could be very economical. Next, please. You see, this is a view of the different forms that were moving. The way we did it was, first we built the of course, the foundation, then the column, then these edge beams that receive the walls, and then the top of the column. And then we apply these forms, wooden forms, and pour the concrete. Very thin concrete, only 1.5 inches thick. And very light reinforcement, just a quarter inch bar. And the reason is so thin is because, I mean, it could be thinner, but it costs you more money. So I discovered that 1.5 inches was the more economical thickness for this kind of structures. Of course, in this being a developable surface, that is a cylinder, you need to have some reinforcement to take care of the live loads. Next. Well, this is the same type of structure in Veracruz for Alcoa, Aluminum Company of America, and this is one of the smelting plants that they built. It's a very, very long building, as you see, and no cantilevers. It's the same as the other, but without cantilevers. You're the central vault and the ties in top also, so we could move the thing. The columns are every 7.5 meters, 25 feet, but we have closer columns where we have the joint. So the expansion joint is in cantilever. Next. Well, this is a view of the inside of the hall with the moving form, which is going in on rails there. Next. Well, then I jumped many of the other type of structures I did, and I come to the hyperbolic paraboloid, which I discovered, well, I discovered this surface in some of the French texts or articles that were published around 36, when I was still in the school in Madrid. And then I started using it in Mexico almost from the very beginning. And this is a, could you focus this a little more? I don't know if it is. Well, anyway, if you have a rectangle on the X or Y plane, and you drop this corner, or you raise the other, then you have a warped or quadrangle. It's not anymore a rectangle in a plan, but it's a warped surface. And it has the property of having straight lines in two directions. So it's the intersection of an infinite number of generators, straight generators, which are all of them parallel to either to this plane or to the other plane. So you have this kind of paradoxical property of having a curved surface with a double curvature. That is, this is a parabola, and this will be another parabola going down. So it's what they call an anticlastic surface, but it's made with straight pieces of with the straight generators, which makes the form work. You can make it with straight pieces of wood. So it's a very economical way to do the form work. And has many other properties. Also has the simplest equation of second degree, which means that you can, and I did, solve the equations of equilibrium, the differential equation of the system of differential equations, once forever, in a very simple way. It's the only surface of second degree that has this property of being able to solve in a simple way the equations of equilibrium. And besides, I mean, it's difficult to make ugly things with it. Next. Well, I think perhaps I should sit. Let me see. Because it's a very uncomfortable position, the one I was there. Now, let's see. Maybe here is better, no? Well, then there are many possibilities of putting together pieces of hyperbolic paraboloid. The simplest one is this one. I mean, you have the origin of the surface is this one, so it will be x and y in the axis. And then if you got four pieces and put them together this way, having symmetry in both directions, if you make a rectangle, for instance, of this, then everything is in equilibrium, and you have a single column. So we call it an umbrella. Then has the property of the vertical loads are transformed in a tangential force along the edges and compressive forces along the arist. So we have four compressions coming to the column, which give you a vertical component. So it's a very simple structure. It works beautifully. The only calculations you need to do is more or less what you have here, a couple of multiplications, when you know how, of course. And then it's very economical. It's very little material, the one you use. Well, you see the thickness in this case is 4 centimeters, so it's 1.5 inches in most cases. Next. Well, you see, this is the first one we built, and it was too flat. I mean, this height was not enough. So the corners, after a couple of weeks, started dropping a little, not too much, but enough to make it not very nice or very sound. So I increased the height until I found the proper dimension for each one of these structures. Next. So then we start building this thing and selling them, because we discovered and we prove that it is one of the cheapest way to cover material, to cover space. And we build thousands of these umbrellas. Normally the size of one of these umbrellas is about 150 square meters, which is 1600 square feet or something like that. That is 15 meters by 10 meters. That is the most economical proportion between columns and roof. But you see, it's a big cantilever in both directions, and it's only very thin. Next. When you have a hole like this, which we have many of them in Mexico, then you can reuse the same formwork many, many times. I mean, here, for instance, I don't remember, but maybe we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sets of forms and move them every week one position. So we were pulling every day one umbrella. So at this rate, the thing is very fast and very, and besides, it's very economical. As you can see here, it is inclined a little by twist, tilting a little these umbrellas. Then you get this very nice north light or sawtooth roof. Next. Well, you see, the construction is very simple. It's almost as simple as a flat slab, because you have beams first in one direction, one in one system of generators, straight beams, then 2x4s in the other direction, and then in this case, it's plywood in top. So it could not be more simple. And of course, you can have this kind of normal scaffolding with wheels and move them from one position to the other. You have a big job. Next. And you see, this is one of these pieces of formwork done in Dallas, and between Dallas and Fort Worth, they did this kind of thing with the wheels and little elevators or whatever you call it. I don't know what is the name of that, but I mean. Very few people can move these things from one position to the other. Joist, no? Hoist. Hoist, okay. Next. Also, we use in Mexico, we use this kind of structure to cover little houses, cheap houses, I mean economical houses, or low cost housing. And you do you start the house by the roof. I mean, you build the column, then the roof, and then you start doing the walls around and the walls inside. So it's a more logical and system of construction, because then you don't need to fill all the rooms with wood in order to put the roof. You put the roof first, and then you do the house around. So it proved to be very economical also. This kind of system. Next. See, this is one of these very, very low-cost housing. But you see the edge of the umbrella is also the lintel of the doors and windows, so you don't need to have lintels there. It's a very simple kind of thing, and this is just in this case, is just cement block. Of course, you have to build this thing later in order to stabilize the thing, because if not, the thing can be moved practically with the hand. I mean, the connection between the column and the top was not very rigid. I mean, we did not do it very rigid because we did not need it. Of course, can be done another way. Next. This is another of the same system of construction with a umbrella and two hotel rooms or bungalows in a hotel in Cuernavaca. Next. Then we start playing with the same form. And this is, for instance, this is the entrance to a laboratory, a pharmaceutical laboratory in Mexico. It's called Saiba. And it's an umbrella, asymmetrical umbrella, with a long arm in one side, about 11 meters, and only 4.5 in the back. So what we did here is to make this very thin and this very, very thick. Of course, the edge is always the same, so you cannot tell that this is very thick. But in this part, we were trying to balance, and we did balance the weight of the moment, you may say, between this load here and this load here, so that for the dead load is balanced. And in Mexico, we have no snow practically. Next. And we start playing again with the same kind of thing. This is another laboratory a few blocks down from the other. And with the same architect, and they say, well, let's do something else, something different. So what we did in that case is to have two pieces of paraboloid, so starting horizontal and ending here in vertical. So it's a 90-degree twist. You put the two together, and then you have a plan. The plan of this is a triangle, comes to here, no? And then you have this coming down, which is the compression thing. Now the end is, it comes to just to have a cantilever with a compression part here and tension at both edges. So the only thing you have to do is to calculate the weight, more or less the center of gravity of the weight, find the moment here, divide by this other lever arm, then you get this, the steel and the compression in this part, and that is all. It's very simple to do. I mean, you don't need to. It's nothing extraordinary. But the cantilever is 40 feet. So it's a lot of cantilever. And in the back, you have to have continue with a wall and then some dead load on the ground. Next. So once you do one of these, I mean, the next step was obvious. You put three of them or four or whatever you want together, and then you get another structure like this, in which you have exactly the same cantilever. This is 40 feet cantilever. This is about 20 feet, 20 feet, 20 feet. So it's 60 feet going around. And then in the back, we have to have two walls and a dead load on the ground. This is supposed to be a band shell. I don't know. I cannot guarantee the acoustical properties of these things. It was, I mean, I had the opportunity to build it, and I did it. Next. This is another, again, the same kind of structure. One, we discover some kind of structure, we start repeating the same thing. This is a double cantilever, which is about 55 feet at its side, so something like that. And it's a... You can see, you will see in the next slide, you will see the shape of this. But you have compression here and tension here in this tie, which is covered with concrete to protect it. So it's a very big double cantilever. Next. Well, you see here the shape, which is the same triangular form, two of them together. When you come with the tension here and the tension here, all the tensions come to this one. And then again, we take it with another tie here in order to have something which is not, I mean, this line horizontal is not very nice. But having this break, it makes a much better shape. So sometimes just by changing a little the You make change a dull structure in something which is good looking. Next. Well, we did a lot of churches. I don't know how many, maybe 30 or so. And I will show you a couple of them. This is one of the most simple. It's just made of four pieces of paraboloid with these four supports. And then we have these little mullions. The mullions of the windows support the edge so that it doesn't move anything. But the main support are the four buttresses at the four sides, in the center of the sides. This is a nice little church. Next. Well, this is another church also. This one in Monterrey, in the north of Mexico. And it's made of two big leaves of a hyperbolic paraboloid. In this case, with the axis, the C axis is becoming in that direction. So what happens is that this part of the shell is a little more than vertical. And still we could pour without outer form. Just by having the steel, when we put the steel on top of this, we pour the concrete by hand, and the steel hold is in place. Well, this structure is 25 meters, that is 80 some feet, 83 feet at each side. So is two big cantilevers again, held together with these two beams and with ties here. And of course, you cannot see in this plan, but we have mullions also, steel mullions or little columns here to support this edge to, and to prevent the movement of this and the deformation, the possible deformation. But this, I show this picture because to show how beautiful could be, how beautiful surface, core surface, can you do with pieces of wood, with straight pieces of wood besides. Next. This is another church. It was the first church I built. And in this one, I was the designer also. I did not work for any other architect. And it's made all, when I was doing umbrellas as a commercial proposition, I was thinking of the possibility of using the umbrella as a formal expression, no? In order to get a expressive structure. And then this is the outside, which is the negative of the inside, because I think probably the church was designed from the inside. Outside. This is the tower, and the tower has this thing, which were added, you see. I mean, the advantage of working in Mexico is that nothing was designed. I mean, we have not so many plans. And so when we built the formwork for this thing in top, which is four pieces of paraboloid looking like a Gothic spire or something like that. We had this in top of this, and it was really a little too short. So one day when I was walking there with the priest, he told me, don't you think that the tower is a little too short, too chaparra, as they say there? And I said, yes, you are right. Then we went to the office, changed this, raised this, I don't know how they raised the whole formwork for that, and we added this part. Next. You see, this is how the tower was without this part. And if you look at this, you can see this part, for instance, which I am doing, going around with the arrow. This is an umbrella, only very exaggerated, very high, no? And if you take these two, it's some kind of four gable structure, which is with the same kind of umbrellas. So all of them are the same structures that we were using as commercial structure, industrial structure. Even these are also umbrellas, the main parts of the nave. And also there are four pieces of paraboloid making the crossing, no, in top. And we have also this folded slab in a little chapel was here. So it was an experiment on the expressive potential of this kind of structure. Next. You see, the church could not be more simple. I mean, it's just three naves. The three naves here, three, four columns here, then the big crossing here, and then the folded slab that you saw before, and this little umbrella. There are two columns here, another column here. This is covered also. So it's a very simple shape. You cannot imagine that this is going to be, anything is going to happen in top. Next. Well, but this is what is happening, no? You see, you have the columns and you have these shapes that look straight from one side, or you look for the other and it's curved, and then the joint, of course, in order to do this so smooth, has to be done by hand. So you have that man there working and plastering, in a way, the concrete or the mortar there. Next. You see, but the idea of the church is this one. You have an asymmetrical umbrella, then you tilt it this way, then you pull this thing up and put together two of them, and then you have a church. So it's a very simple idea. Next. But you see, the result looks kind of complicated, but it is not indeed. I mean, apart from the But you see, the columns are very funny because they are, it's a triangle in plan and another triangle, but inverted in top, and joined with these warped surfaces that are a continuation of the vaults in the top. Next. So you see, here you can see better the triangle in the back and the triangle in the front, and then how they are joined with this warped surface that is the continuation of the roof. And when you look from different points of view, you start to see very strange things. So you can imagine the poor priest, when they saw this thing going up, they were really scared to death. No? And you know, the ladies around the neighborhood, they came and say, well, how nice is the church you are building? They came every day, and the priest looked at them and say, how can they find it nice or beautiful? Well, now they are very pleased because it has become very popular. But you see the shapes that you can get just with a simple surface, like the one I showed at the beginning. Next. And this is the inside of the church finish. Well, of course, they keep adding things, you see, and they have more images and more, and they are hanging things from the roof and everything. I mean, it's changed in a way. But the structure, I have this picture of the original structure without too many additions, and I think they are nice. Next. Well, you can also use the same surface, but cutting it by the parabolas. Instead of cutting it by the straight edges, as you have seen in the other cases, you can also cut by the principal parabola. So a paraboloid is also a translation surface in which a curve, this curve, moves parallel to itself along this other curve. So you can see the what they call anticlastic surface, which is like a saddle. But of course, you have straight lines still there, so it can be built with these straight lines. Next, so I will show you some of the possibilities. This is a garage in a carport, in a residence, in a house in El Pedregal in Mexico. And it's for two cars. And it's just a little piece of paraboloid curve like that. Next. This is the Cosmic Ray Laboratory, which was this fourth shell I built, and the first one which was published in the American magazines. And it has the property that this part, this top part, up to here maybe, is only 5/8 of an inch thick, because that was the condition. So it's probably the thinnest shell built for permanent purposes, still there. And of course, instead of using a cylinder, I use these two pieces, these two paraboloids, so that the double curvature make it much more rigid, the form. And then this is just a decorative kind of wall, but I like it very much because it produces this kind of shadows, you see, and also produce shadows on the lower part. So it was a big success for me. Next. We have some problems, I mean, because building it, because it was the first time that we were doing this kind of curvature, and we didn't know how to do it, and we have a lot of problems with the wood until we were learning little by little later. But this was in 1952. And you can see now in Mexico at that time, you could see the beautiful clouds and the sky and everything. Now you cannot see anything. Everything is gray and nothing. I mean, it's a smoke, terrible. Next. Well, of course, you can put together two of these saddles, making this intersection, this growing vault. And this we use for the first time in the stock exchange in Mexico. It's the vault covering the stock exchange big room there, where they sell and exchange shares and bonds and all these kind of things. So it's a, you can see here is four, I don't know how, 40 meters, which is 46 feet by 84 feet is the size. It's a rectangular thing, but has the advantage over the cylinder, because the typical thing is to have two cylinders intersecting, which is the typical groin bolt. But in this case, you don't need to, you can use always only straight pieces of wood. So it's a tremendous advantage from the point of view of the easy construction. Next. Well, you see, this is the actual construction. It was built on top of the third floor and in the middle of, with no possibility of light, direct light from, because it was surrounded by other buildings. So you can see how we put beams in one direction, then the 2x4s in the other, and then we start filling this with parallel boards, and then a wedge, and parallel boards, and a wedge. So in this way, you can cover the whole surface. It was when I built this in some magazine, in the ACI magazine, a professor told that it was impossible to build a paraboloid with wood, with parallel boards, which of course is true, but we built it. You know, so nothing happened. But the professor was just thinking of the geometrical possibility, and with the condition that you use only parallel boards. Next. Well, this is the reinforcement of the vault, and a little closer than normal, because it was the first time that we were doing something so vertical at the corners. So in order to hold the concrete, we started experimenting with having a little more reinforcement than necessary. Next. And then you have the inside of the hole. By cutting the groin bolt with inclined planes, then we get light in the four sides. So it's quite impressive when it was finished, and it was kind of nice. Next. But I learned a lot in this structure, because we have a lot of time, and I could develop the equations for doing all the numbers, which I like very much. No? Then the next time, for the same architect, the architect of the Stock Exchange, it was Enrique de la Mora, a very well-known and very nice architect and person in Mexico. And I did that was the first work I did for him. And after that, I start building more. This is a church he got, and we built three of these vaults, in this case, a square. So I discovered the possibility of having an edge without any reinforcement, no rib or no thickness, no extra thickness, just the 4 centimeters, the 1.5 inch edge with nothing. By having the thing square, you can annulate all forces in the edge and transfer everything to the two groins, to the two diagonal groins, which are the ones who really bring the load to the ground. And then when we discover this, we start playing with the same. Another toy for us, no? Next. So we build this one in Guadalajara, in the north, I don't know for what purpose. Next. This was built in Oslo, in Norway, after a lecture. I had a tour or lecture through Scandinavia, and my stop in Oslo, I drew something like this in a napkin, and they built it. They built it later, of course, doing all kind of calculations and things. No, but anyway, they were very nice, and I understand they put the name of this place is my name, just because I did this little sketch. Next. This is another triangular shell, and it was built in Acapulco in a hotel, one of these big hotels, and it was a nightclub. But it is a very nice, I mean, again, the architect in this case was another architect, told me, well, I want you to build one of your things in Acapulco for me. And I went there and they have already built this. This wall was already built. So I have to look for support here, look for another point in the back, and it's a triangular, it's a equilateral triangular vault with the center a little higher than the edges. But you can see the edge is only the 1.5 inch, and you cannot see any rib or anything. It's just the pure shell. I think it's one of the nicest and probably more beautiful shells I have built. Then I discovered little by little that I was able to do beautiful things, because it was a surprise for me. I never thought that I have any artistic ability when I was a student, and that is the reason I devote myself more to the technical matters, and then I discovered that I have some kind of magical touch, and some of the things I did were very beautiful without my real purpose. I mean, I did not really try so hard to make it beautiful, but perhaps I could not avoid to do something so that the proportion were the right one and the detailing was the proper one. Maybe the lack of detailing. Next. This is another one. 5 points in this case, 5 sides. And it's for a restaurant, and it's inside of another big cell, which is supposed to be in the movie house. It was a crazy thing, you see, because you see this bar there, that is for the projector or projection booth. And this hole there, which is round, is for the operator to come here and operate the machines. I never saw it working. Next, but the picture is nice. This is another series of growing balls in a plan copy from the airport of Yamasaki in San Luis, Missouri. But I wanted to prove to myself and to everybody that it could be done in a simplest way than the one they did it there. Because the dimensions are practically the same. It's 100 feet square, each one of these balls. And in this case, you have absolutely no reinforcement, no ribs, no nothing. The one in San Luis has ribs at the edge and in the diagonal, which are maybe 2 or 3 feet by 4 feet or something like that. Enormous arches, you see. And I know why this happened, you see, because the architect was in, I think he was in Detroit, Yamasaki at that moment. And then the engineer was in New York, was Tedesco. And then the contractor in another place. And nobody understood each other. So at the end, they could not tell it, well, why don't we do this thing and try to make it simpler? No, well, anyway, I did this. This is Bacardi, the room factory in Mexico, near Mexico City. Next. And you see the construction is always the same kind of 2x4s over the other thing. This is the construction of one of these, the second set of walls, because we built first three that you may almost see in the back, three of them, and now we were building the another three in front. Next. You see, this is the second set, but you see it's nothing but the edge here. We have this little rib because the windows are coming in this plane, and I wanted to have something a little more rigid to receive the mullions of the window so that they do not punch the roof, but they are not for structural purposes. And it's 100 feet. Next. Then you see the inside with six of them. So you have this kind of leaf of light in the middle of the vaults. It's quite impressive. Nothing happens inside. I mean, what happens here, they have a little tables there for bottling. It's the bottling plant. But they have so much money. I mean, they earn so much money by selling rum, but they can afford to have this for nothing. Next. Another one, this is a 8th side. That is a restaurant in Xochimilco, the floating gardens they call in Mexico. And it's again the same idea with 8 sides, 8 supports, symmetrical of course. And but then we have from column, I mean from support to support is 100 feet. From point to point is 150 almost. So what happened here is that just by cutting the structure with this angle, the thing looks a little more gracious. And also by continuing this line, here, I mean, this structure was so successful, was published, and everybody tried to copy. They have built, I don't know how many of these, here in this country, after that. But no one is so gracious like this one, because they come with this to a peak, and it's not the same. And they don't give the cut, the proper cut, and it's not the same. So we have a lot of fun doing this one. Next, you see here how we did, I mean, the groin comes to the ground, but the edge, we twisted it like this, so we give continuity to the form. You see the size of the thing, you can see the people here. Next. The plan maybe has to do also with the beauty, no? Because it's a 2 squares crossing each other. That is all the trick. Next. Another picture of the same thing. Next. This is another church. The last one I am going to show is an open chapel in Cuernavaca, near Mexico. And it's in the top of a hill. Next, you see it's an open chapel with a window in the back only, in the back there. But this thing is open. The trees are grown, and so the people are listening to the mass either under the shell or under the trees. This is, and the cars have parked here. But it's a beautiful place. A beautiful location on top of this hill and overlooking the valley of Cuernavaca. Next. You see, again, it's a question of, it could not be more simple. You have a big paraboloid like this, you see, 2 points down and 2 points up, and then you cut it properly, and the only thing you have to do is to make a cut, make another cut, make 4 cuts, and that is all. And then you get this shape, and but you have to play with the rise of all this structure, giving the proper curvature and all these things. Next, and then this is the construction. You can see the rows of these lines where each one of the generators is placed. Next, this is not an economical structure, of course, but that was not the point. Well, you can see how this is built on this hill, which is a free gravel hill, a volcanic stone which floats in, is full of holes and floats in the water. So the church is really floating on this floating gravel. We have a big footing here, then a continuous footing here. This is a tie, which is covered with concrete, and it's another tie. I mean, the whole thing is tied together. And you see the reinforcement in place and ready to be poured. Next. This is they are putting the reinforcement there, and people are hanging with ropes from the top and also with these kind of steps, or wooden steps, to tie together the thing. Next. You see they start pouring the concrete, only 1 inch and a half, and just by doing it every day they did 3, 10 feet or something like that, because we didn't have too much people there. Next, so you see they are finishing, and then when they finish there, they come down, taking all this wood and finishing the surface and getting it ready for the waterproofing. Of course, we have some steel steps here for the people to go up there and then be able to waterproof or repair whatever they have to do. Next. Well, this is another view of the beautiful location. Next. Well, as I was telling you at the beginning, I discovered the limit of the structure, of the type of structure. And so I started thinking of the possibility of continue using these small umbrellas, but having a big resistant structure, which is different than the umbrella. This is this idea of these trees, which are about 150 feet square. For a exhibition hall that was part of the competition for the sports palace for the Olympics in Mexico that we won. I won with two other architects, friends of mine. So the idea was the same. I mean, you have in this case, concrete structure, and then at the end, the leaves are really the umbrellas, the little umbrellas, probably prefabricated because this was never built. Next. And this is the sports palace, which is the one we won the competition. And then you see, in this case, I use the same idea. I have steel arches, it's a series of steel arches with a unusual, you may say, the division of the sphere. I mean, normally you see the sphere being divided by radial arches. In this case, there are gray circles of the sphere coming opening like a fan in two directions and giving this kind of panels, which are not square, only square the one in the center. And then the little umbrellas or paraboloids covering these surfaces. So and then in top of these are aluminum nets, indeed, aluminum pipe forming the paraboloids. And then in top of that, we use plywood and then in top of the plywood, copper tiles or copper foil or something like that. But you see, in this case, this is a very explanatory picture because you have the seating is a circular structure of concrete which does not touch the roof. And you have the concrete buttresses here supporting each one of the arches in both directions. So it's a very safe structure because if an arch fails, all the other help and nothing happens. Next, I'm going to pass very fast because this is a picture of the competition for the palace. Next, the advantage is that you have practically no facade because we compare with the, and this is the construction of the first arch and the only walls, which are also paraboloids of brick, which give a very nice shadows. Next. Yes, okay. Well, you see the arch is also not very orthodox because you have the compression arc in this cross. This cross is in compression. Then you have intention this piece and intention these pieces also. And the reason of this is that the same happened with the other arches in the other direction. So you can put in top of these compression pieces, you have the paraboloids. Next. Yes, the workers there. This is the compression pieces, which are 30 by 30, that is 1 foot square. They are H beams. Next, you see, until they cover the whole thing. and is ready to put the secondary structure. Next. See the hull still, next. And these are the paraboloids made of pipe with a patented a connector which is called triodetic. It's from Canada. So they build this, they are not all of them equal, no? They are four repetitions. Next. And then they just pull it with a pulley, they pull this thing up, hang it there. Next. Well, they come there. Everything is very, very, you may say, handicraft or something like that. Next. And then they have this, and they start putting the plywood. Next. The plywood there. Next. You see part of the roof already built. Next. The inside of the hall.